Who could this be? Who was that?
Hmm? Oh, I don't know. But whoever it was dropped a box copy of Life and Death in our front door.
That's weird.
Who would ever drop a game like this in her front door?
Oh, god damn it.
What? What's wrong?
It's a floppy disk game, and I need a floppy disk reader to play this game with.
Well, sounds like you need to go to Amazon.
Will do. You know, I've played Life and Death so many times over the years that I never really thought of owning a box copy of the game. Ain't it convenient that somebody dropped this in my front door. If I ever find the person who dropped it there, I want to thank them. Well, either that or I have to give it back to them, I don't know. Okay, now that I have a physical copy of the game, I need to buy a floppy disk reader in order to play this game. Just a quick browse to Amazon should do the trick, find a good disk reader, and voila. Okay, well that's getting shipped, how about we take a look at some of the surgery simulation games that were released in the early to mid 1980s. Back in the early days of video games, surgery simulation games were not as common as they are now. Well, kinda. One of the very first examples of a surgery simulation game was with Microsurgeon for the Intellivision, released in 1982. In this game, you take control of a robot probe that's been planted inside the patient.
A robot probe, eh?
Oh, sort of like nanobots. Nanobots?
Nanobots aren't just for Christmas. Heracles is in your system, it's there forever.
And my mind is done. We are their curse. Yes, madam. Yes, you did.
No! God! No!
Yep, we're fucked. Don't worry, this nanobot isn't infectious unlike the nanobots from that shitty-ass Bond movie. The goal is to save the patient by targeting all sorts of diseases that could potentially kill the patient. You want to make sure you check the patient's health in the status screen in order to see how well the patient is doing while tracking down each and every illness from one organ to another as quickly as possible, or else the nanobot's energy runs out, and the game's over. But here's a problem. If you're playing this game for the first time like I was, it's kind of hard to tell what's going on. Most of the games at the time require you to look at the manual in order to get the full context of the game. To make it worse, you have to play this game with two controllers and with the layouts attached to them. That's just great, right? Not only do you have to keep an eye on the patient's health and the nanobot's energy while targeting bacteria and tumors, but you also have to take a look at the control layout in case you forgot what button does what. Call me out of touch with the Intellivision for all I care, but I don't like this control method. I mean, it worked for this game, but playing this game with two controllers just feels too excessive for a one-player game, and don't even get me started with playing this game with a friend. Also, the directional disc on the controllers are just awful to play this game with. You have to press hard on the disc in order for the game to register your inputs. I can't stress enough how annoying this is, especially when the nanobot moves so slow that it'll get stuck in places that are not branching through the organs. Overall, Microsurgeon for the Intellivision is a fun little game that isn't gory or graphic for a surgery simulation game, but it's still good in its own right. So good, in fact, that in 2018, a remake of Microsurgeon was announced for the Intellivision Amico.
I guess that's a no.
3 years after the release of Microsurgeon on the Intellivision, Publisher Information Systems for Medicine, or ISM for short, later released a surgery simulation game for the Commodore Amiga and the Apple Macintosh titled The Surgeon.
Welcome to The Surgeon.
Oh, so that's where my Microsoft Paint drawing went. Here's what the game is about. You meet up with a 65-year-old patient named Thomas Jones who appears to have some aorta issues that requires medical attention. You can prescribe him some painkillers for his lower back if he has any, request an ultrasound to see if his aorta is bulging, and if it isn't yet, then you can have somebody observe his aorta for him, and if it is bulging and it looks serious, then it's time to operate. Sometime this year would be great. Okay, so now we're in the operating room. What the hell do I do now? I can't access his surgical tools, and the only thing I can do is drag the window over and under. I will say though, for a 65-year-old man, they gave Mr. Jones some nice abs. So as it turns out, you have to access the surgical tools by holding the right button on the mouse, then releasing it once you've selected the tool you need. Once you've washed your hands, rub some antiseptic on Mr. Jones' abdomen, and inject some antibiotics on him, you are now ready to use the scalpel. And this is where the game starts getting tedious. Not only do you have to make straight incisions from top to bottom, but you also have to make sure you don't cut anything that could potentially damage Mr. Jones' organs. That's exactly what I did here. I've played Life and Death so many times that I'm familiar with this operation, yet couldn't understand what I was doing wrong with the operation in this game. You mean to tell me that I must cut the peritoneal fat without cutting the colon? Oh, and what about the peritoneum? You can't just cut the area with a scalpel, oh no. That would puncture the bloody aorta, which will eventually
kill the patient.
Oh, that's just great. Not only did I kill my patient on accident, but I have to go back to medical school? There isn't even a medical school in this game to begin with! The game only has one operation, being the open aortic surgery, and nothing more! If you kill Mr. Jones on accident, the game resets without telling you what you did wrong. So it's just a matter of trial and error to know what treatment will keep Mr. Jones from screaming in his deathbed. Not even the Mac version is safe from this tedious gameplay. It's arguably better than the Amiga version, but it's still the same damn game on a monochrome computer. In conclusion, The Surgeon is an interesting surgeon simulator game that I like to think only a licensed doctor with an MD could possibly master. In fact, in this 1987 issue of Macworld, an actual licensed MD reviewed this game, stating that The Surgeon could be, and I quote, "educational and challenging to a non-medical personnel."
So basically, nobody. Right, so now that we have a brief introduction of what the surgery simulation games were like back in the early to mid 80s, we now have a clear idea of what to expect with Life and Death. Now, while my floppy disk reader won't be arriving until tomorrow, I need a rest, so I'll see you guys tomorrow morning.
Hey, you're back.
Well, first of all, good morning to you.
And second of all, you are just in time for my delivery to arrive. But in the meantime, let's talk about Life and Death, shall we?
Life and Death is a surgery simulation game developed and published by the software Toolworks in 1988. You might know the software Toolworks for their infamous series of Mario Edutainment games released in the early 90s. If you thought 1988 was a scarier time for this game to come out, well, imagine what it was like to be a Super Mario Bros. Fan in the early 90s when the Mario Edutainment series of games came out.
Warning, do not buy or play this program if you are faint of heart.
What kind of warning is that? It's not like there's something graphic going on down there, oh my god.
Inside the box, you get a pair of latex gloves and a surgical mask for your doctor cosplaying needs.
For some reason when I got this game, it did not come with a surgical mask, but if I had to guess, the previous user must have used it themselves. No biggie, because I have a pair of masks in my nightstand I can use to cosplay. But now my next problem is the gloves. I mean, come on. I wouldn't want to be putting my hands on a pair of 34-year-old latex gloves. That would be insane.
Along with the gloves and mask, you get a 3.5-inch floppy disk copy of the game, and a code wheel that kind of looks like one of those pagers that most people used back in the early 80s. You also get an operating procedures manual giving you instructions on how to install and play the game, an orientation memo from the fictional chief of surgery that gives you a guided tour of the fictional Toolworks General Hospital, a big instructional booklet on how to treat patients along with a glossary just in case you didn't know what a pelvis meant. Also inside the box is a booklet giving you a brief history and evolution of surgery. Well, there goes the neighborhood.
Yeah, you got that right.
And last but not least is a product line pamphlet. This pamphlet shows you a list of software products released by the software Toolworks circa 1989 to 1990, giving you a description of their software, along with some contact information to place an order to local distributors for the game you're interested in purchasing.
Well, I'll be damned. My floppy disk reader has arrived, and perfect timing as well.
Oh man, I can't wait to load this game up. This is gonna be fun.
Yeah. Get on with it, come on.
Well, I bet you're fun at parties.
Are you finished with the installation?
Yeah, just need to load the game up and...
Way to go, resident skinny fat ass. The power is out. Hey, don't blame me. I paid the electricity bill on time. Then why is the power out? How the hell should I know? It could possibly be a brownout for all I care. Okay, so what do we do now?
Hello? We still have a game left to review. How about we kick back, relax, and eventually get an eye strain from all the red light in front of us?
Okay, fair enough. I can get behind that.
After installing the game and loading it through the DOS terminal, the game starts with a software Toolworks logo, followed by a title screen of a dead person's feet.
You know, come to think of it, what exactly killed the patient for them to end up in the title screen?
I don't know, but if I had to guess, it might have been the case of... copyright.
Oh wait, they're still alive, I can see their toe moving.
Huh.
Moving on, you are now inside the Toolworks General Hospital, and according to the memo, you are now on the 8th floor, working in the abdominal surgery division. Yes, in case you weren't aware, you're only an abdominal surgeon, not a brain surgeon. You'd have to wait 2 years later for Life and Death 2 of the Brain to come out in order to take the role of a brain surgeon.
Well, if I'm not able to become a brain surgeon until the sequel, then why have a picture of somebody picking up a brain on the back of the cover?
Upon arriving the corridor of the hospital, Nurse Monica Pierce, yes, that's her name, tells you to sign in and report to medical school for orientation. After you're done with medical school, you can now start treating your patients or visit the staff room. Yes, the STAF room.
I don't even know which spelling error is worse, this or the third floor from Three Sisters Story.
Inside the staff room is the nurse who turns to your direction and hands out a folder that shows you your assigned team members for the surgery. It also tells you their technical expertise as well as their personal background. You can only assign two of them to your team, but whoever you choose doesn't really make a difference because they don't actually do anything besides warn you about the patient's heartbeat. Yeah, thanks Ken for reminding me to inject atropine to the patient instead of, oh I don't know, doing it yourself? Also inside the room is a filing cabinet which upon clicking it shows you a complete list of honor roll doctors who completed the game. Clicking on the paper taped to the side of the filing cabinet is just a screen that shows an advertisement space available for this game, and that I need to call the number and ask for Gus. And last but not least is an IBM PC displaying some sort of screen that shows a line of basic code, which I have no clue what it does besides telling you the available memory it has. Outside the staff room, we have an intercom that doesn't do anything apart from allowing you to change the difficulty, activate nightmare mode, toggle sound, or change the control method to whatever you see fit. You can even customize your own signature, which is a nice touch. I needed a phallic joke, so I drew a penis. After getting to know who our team members are, amongst other things you can do in the game, let's waste no time and start paying our first patient a visit. So once you're inside their room, you can start examining their abdomen by poking around to see if they're feeling any pain around their midsection. Now, while I could go in depth on telling you how to diagnose and treat your patients according to the manual, I'd be sitting here all day. So instead, here's a video tutorial from 1988, courtesy of a former doctor who used to work at Toolworks General.
Hello, I'm Vladimir Claude, or Vlad for short. I'm a doctor currently working at Toolworks General Hospital, and today, we're going to teach you the basics of how to properly diagnose and treat your patients. Let's get started.
Now, when upon entering the patient's room, you must first follow these two procedures before treating your patients. Number 1, click on the clipboard and read their symptoms. Number 2, examine the patient by palpating their midsection. If the patient isn't feeling any pain on their abdomen, it's possible they might be dealing with intestinal gas, which means it's time to pull out your gas mask because one of you unlucky souls have to go to an observation room with the patient and witness them shit their pants. Now, if the patient is feeling pain all around their midsection, you must prescribe them medicine by clicking on Medicate. If they only feel pain on one side or both, they might have a painful case of the kidney stones, so just a quick scan through our x-ray machine and a referral to one of our urologists can help them piss their stones out.
And I know that for a fact because I'm practically dickless. And one of the most common cases we usually get here at Toolworks General that begs to be a contagious disease is appendicitis.
If your patient is suffering from pain on one side of their abdomen or both, but isn't showing any signs of kidney stones on our x-ray scanner, then they must be suffering from appendicitis. Therefore, your patient requires an immediate operation, or else your patient will suffer from a ruptured appendix and die as a result of your negligence.
So that's usually the first four cases we get here at Toolworks General Hospital. Hopefully this video guide has helped you through on how to properly treat your patients, and avoid getting sued for impersonation. Now if you'll excuse me, I have a notice to appear in court today, and if I don't go to court today, I'm going to prison. Until next time, whenever that might be, this was Vladimir Claude. Thanks for watching.
Okay, so now that we know what to do when it comes to treating our patients, I decided to palpate the patient's abdomen and the patient screamed when I touched their sides. So let's order an x-ray and see what they've got. Well, I'm one of the unlucky souls to start the game with a patient who has been diagnosed with appendicitis. You know what that means. Time to operate. Okay, I'll just click on the operate checkbox, draw my penis on the signature box, and whoa, Dr. Franklin called me from the links on the line too, eh? Well then, just a quick typing of random numbers on the phone, and now it's time to pull out your mask and gloves, because this is what life and death is about. Surgery. You have two operations to complete, the appendectomy and the open aortic surgery. Now, before you pick up the scalpel and start incising right away, you first have to prepare the surgical site, like turning the anesthesia on, washing your hands with soap, put on the gloves, covering the area in drapes, rubbing antiseptic on the patient's abdomen, injecting antibiotics, and applying the blood bag to the IV. And now you can start the incision right away. That is, if you typed in the correct code. Yes, apparently in this game you can't perform surgery on someone unless you've typed in the correct code number. In fact, the game tells you that it's considered poor protocol not to return the call. Well, as it turns out, you can't play the full game without using the code wheel, meaning that the game is copy protected unless you submit the correct code number from the code wheel. So if you happen to lose the code wheel, you're fucked unless you find an online webpage that happens to have the code numbers. So after submitting the correct code number on the phone, I'm finally able to perform surgery on our patient without the chief of surgery slapping me on the wrist for not following their stupid protocol. Once you've set everything up again, you can now pick up the knife and start cutting right away. The goal is to open the patient, cauterize some bleeders, and cut the swollen area of the appendix. This is where you could easily screw up and not make any further progress in the game if you don't make the proper incisions or inject the correct drug in time. Like I've mentioned before, I've played Life and Death so many times over the years that I find it rather easy to complete this game, and I couldn't have done it without watching some video tutorials on YouTube. If you're playing this game for the first time and don't know what to do in this operation, I highly recommend watching Elite Shopping Cart's video tutorial on these operations. These help a lot. Right, so now that we know how to perform the appendectomy operation, it's time to use the clamps to lift the appendix, pierce the artery, then tie it off, and cut the right side of the mesoappendix membrane. Once we're done with that, we can now clamp the higher and lower part of the appendix and finally cut it. And with that, it's finally time to wrap up and get the hell out of here. If the operation turned out successful, the chief of surgery will congratulate you, which means that you've made it to the second stage of the abdominal surgery. But if you happen to mess up the operation, you have to do it again. Luckily, I don't have to repeat the operation, so I can get to my next patient without any hassle. Like in the earlier portion of the game, you have to repeat the examination of the abdomen, but this time you only have 3 cases instead of 4. If you remember the surgeon, the cases are exactly the same as this one. No pain in the midsection, request an x-ray scan and prescribe the patient some pain pills for their arthritis. A lump in their midsection? Request an ultrasound and see how large the aorta is. If it isn't bulging right now, request an observation. And if it is bulging, operate on them right away.
Well, it's your turn to operate this time.
Oh shit, for real? Are you sure you got this?
Yeah, I think so.
Alright, take it away, doctor.
So this is the final operation in this game, the open aortic surgery. If you remember the operation in the surgeon, this is exactly the same operation the game had you perform. But unlike the surgeon, cutting the peritoneal fat won't damage the colon, and cutting the peritoneum after nicking it won't puncture the aorta, which will eventually
kill the patient.
Moving on to the aorta, the goal is to insert a Dracon graft and sew it in place. But before we do that, we first have to inject some heparin on the patient. This will help make the blood thinner. Not that it matters, because we're going to stop the blood flow in the aorta anyways. Okay, now that we got that out of the way, let's open up the aorta and sew the graft in place. All we need to do is give it 3 stitches on all the sides, close this up, rinse and repeat. Of course, we have to stitch everything back up, remove the gut back covering the guts, and put the guts back in place, more stitching and skin staples that took me longer than it should. So after all of that, if the operation turned out to be a success, the chief of surgery will congratulate you, and the game will end with a certificate of graduation with your name on it. So that's Life and Death for the MS-DOS, and for a game that was released on the IBM PCs at the time, it's pretty good. Considering the 4-color limitations of the CGA graphics card, it looks really well detailed. Even the sampled speeches, despite it being cheesy as hell, is really impressive to hear on a PC speaker. Now of course, this game is not all perfect. From a logical standpoint, this game makes no sense when you first play it. Like, how am I still a doctor after killing a patient with a lethal drug? Why is it considered poor protocol not to return the call when I'm about to operate on a patient with appendicitis? Can't I just return the call after my patient's surgery? Why do my female patients scream like a male when they feel pain on their abdomen? Why does a chief of surgery refer to women who die of appendicitis as a he? And also, is anyone going to stop me from scribbling all over the patient's abdomen with a scalpel? No wonder why Toolworks General has ceased operations after Life and Death 2. If they're not going to take action against quacks like me, then why run a hospital in the first place? At this point, I might as well be every patient's worst fucking nightmare when it comes to performing surgery on them. And speaking of which, let's talk about the nightmare mode in this game. This is by far the hardest, most impossible difficulty of them all. I've played the appendectomy operation under nightmare mode multiple times that I wasn't able to get to the subcutaneous fat layer. You can't even make the first cut because the patient starts having abnormal heartbeats. Trying to use the forceps on these bleeders is a bitch. You have to be pixel perfect in order to stop the bleeding, and by the time you clamp them in the correct spot, you still have other bleeders to clamp. Not to mention that your patient will lose a lot of blood in the process. So much blood, in fact, that you need to replace the empty blood bag with a new one. Oh, but good luck trying to put up a fight with the bleeders anyway, because if you still can't clamp the bleeders in the correct spot, then your patient dies along with your pride in playing this game.
No wonder we've been playing this game in easy mode. Like, what's the point of having the difficulty setting if the game plays the same for the most part? I'll go check it out. Retriku?
Yeah?
I don't want to alarm you, but...
Oh my god.
Warning! Do not buy or play this program if you're faint of heart!
Okay, that should do it.
This is by far the hardest, most impossible dick...